Dear friends, a very good morning and a warm welcome to all of you from CMC Vellore and a COVID Command Center training desk, especially to our nursing friends who are in the audience from CMC and various parts of the country. The role of nurses during the ongoing pandemic has been anything but usual. Our nurses not only acting as extended support for doctors and leading into patient care, but have had to take it upon themselves to also act as patients, family, and caregivers. In such unprecedented times in history, they have demonstrated highest levels of professionalism and transformational leadership. The role of nursing during this pandemic, which is ongoing since last year, has been exemplary. Our nurses are not only acting as extended support in our healthcare systems to our doctors, but also leading into the patient care, but also have taken upon themselves to also act upon as patients, family, and caregivers. In such unprecedented times in our history, they have demonstrated the highest levels of professionalism and transformational leadership. A typical day in the life of a COVID nurse still continues to be getting up early, looking after the family needs, being prompt on duty, doffing in the PPEs, and working in extremely difficult conditions. Yet, they have gone beyond the call of the duties, handling several complicated patients, which they normally do in the past. They are at risk of carrying the virus back home, yet they are saving lives and sacrificing for the sake of a fellow human being. We salute all the nurses as we recently remembered the Nurses Day on 12th May, 2021. Thank you all for your relentless and selfless service. CMC has been conducting the sessions, and we are specifically hosting the session with all of you to share the practices at CMC and our mission hospitals, especially from the nursing perspective. So before we start, I would like to share a prayer which has been inspiration for many, and especially for our founder, Dr. Ida Scudder. Father, whose life is within me and whose love is ever about me, grant that thy life may be maintained in my life today and every day, that with gladness of heart, without haste or confusion of thought, I may go about my daily tasks, conscious of ability to meet every rightful demand, seeing the larger meaning of little things and finding beauty and love everywhere and in the sense of thy presence, may I walk through the hours, breathing the atmosphere of love rather than anxious striving. Amen and God bless. I now invite our moderators, who are one of the most dynamic nursing leaders, Dr. Bala Sitaraman, who's a nursing superintendent, and Dr. Vatsala Sadan, Dean College of Nursing, to take through this session. Over to both of you, ma'am. Thank you.
Friends, very good morning to all. As Dr. Thomas said, Dr. Vatsala Sadan and I will be moderating today's session on COVID-19 second wave nursing management and challenges. I am indeed delighted and honored to welcome each and every one of you to this webinar. I will give a brief overview of this webinar. And to begin with, I thought it will be appropriate to orient you all about the main difference between first and second wave in terms of patient categorization and preparedness of nurses. Let me share a few slides. An overview of COVID-19 second wave nursing management and challenges. As I told you, the main difference between first and second wave in terms of categorization, all of us know that we have basically three categories, mild, moderate, and severe. We have classified the same thing into level 1, level 2, level 3. Mainly for the allocation of beds for patients based on their requirement of oxygen and other needs. As we all know, in the first wave, We had level 1 to 3. Now also we have level 1 to 3. But only difference is during this wave, we have added one more level, that is level 1.5. And the main difference in level 1 between last year and this year is, last year, all the level 1 patients were admitted to hospital from March to December. Because only in December, we started talking about home isolation. Then gradually, we started sending patients for home isolation. Whereas during this wave, level 1 patients, majority of them are recommended for home isolation. Patients who don't fit for home isolation alone are admitted to hospital. And otherwise, the new level that we have added during this wave is level 1.5, basically to allocate bed oxygen beds for patients who require less than 4 liters and more than 4 liters, because then only we'll be able to escalate our care depending upon the level 3 beds availability. So for that reason only, we have added one more level during this wave. And as far as the nurses preparedness is concerned, last year, we had trained about more than 1,000 nurses to take care of patients in any areas, especially even level 1 and level 2. Whereas for level 3 nursing care alone, we started preparing nurses to take care of critically ill patients in ICUs. Whereas this time, the preparedness, level of preparation is definitely higher. The need is higher than the last wave, because when we say level 1, not only stable patients, even patients who require oxygen and suddenly they become ill, they become sick. So nurses need to know even level 2 kind of care in level 1 clinical areas also. The preparation was definitely at the higher level. So we had to prepare nurses for taking care of even NIV patients in the general ward, so-called level 1 ward. And I take the privilege of touching upon challenges also. As far as the challenges are concerned, we have challenges with manpower. On one side, the need for manpower is more. On the other hand, availability of nurses is going down due to various reasons. And when I say requirement is no more, as I said earlier, the kind of patients whom we have as inpatients are, they require higher level of care. So nurse to patient ratio, we need to keep at least 1:3 or 1:4, except in ICUs. ICUs, as usual, 1:1 to 1:1.5, we are able to maintain. And nurses are not only involved in nursing care, they are also performing multiple tasks. For example, swabbing. We have trained around 150 nurses on how to do swab, and everywhere in the hospital, the nurses are involved in taking swabs. And home isolation, around 500 patients are on home isolation. We have a group of nurses to do home isolation, and we have another group of people who are involved in vaccination. And recently, we started nurses for monitoring oxygen usage in all the clinical areas, especially level 2 and level 3 areas, because the main reason is to conserve oxygen by minimizing the wastage and by using the oxygen effectively. And when I said availability of manpower is down, the reasons are due to COVID infection. Our own staff are affected with infection, and many are on quarantine, and many are having comorbidity, so we are unable to post them in COVID areas. And the second challenge is redeployment. We have mobilized staff from various other departments. For example, staff who worked in MHC, staff who worked in Shell Hospital, Eye Hospital, they were all moved now to the clinical areas after the training. So redeployment was a real challenge for us. And the third one is recruitment. Side by side, we are doing recruitment also in order to meet the needs of the manpower. And training, as I told you, all the nurses need to be trained to take care of patients on NIV and oxygen administration using various devices. So that is again a challenge. And as all of you are aware, there are important challenges with the oxygen availability and also huge need for equipment. So these days it is very challenging to get even equipment smoothly. So there again, we are facing the challenges. So these are some of the points as a moderator, I wanted to cover. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Vatsala Sadan to introduce the speakers.
Good morning. I bring greetings from the faculty and students of College of Nursing, CMC, Vellore. Once again, a very warm welcome to each one of you, dear friends. As we celebrate the International Nurses Week, it's my pleasant privilege to meet each one of you in this virtual platform. Wish you all happy Nurses Week. Yes, nurses, a voice to lead, a vision for future healthcare. On the Nurses Day, May 12th, we heard from many people, even on the social media, many greetings, wishes. Some of those I just wanted to quote here. Thank you, COVID heroes. They know what it takes to save lives. India today hails our brave nurses. Indian nurses quietly save lives. The true frontline COVID warriors. Silently and sincerely, they fight against COVID. Unsung heroes of India's COVID war. My dear nursing fraternity, we are in the midst of a second wave of the COVID-19 pandemic. Here we have the nursing captains of CMC's COVID war to share their experiences and expertise with regard to appropriate nursing management of COVID patients at different levels of care, the need of the hour. Let me quickly introduce the panelists for today's webinar without taking much of their time. The first speaker is Mrs. Jailinda Christopher, Deputy Nursing Superintendent of CMC. She is the professor and head of emergency nursing department, and she has 26 years of teaching experience. And during her STF senior training fellowship, she had experience in Adams Kovli Shop Trauma Care Center, University of Maryland, Baltimore, and Kansas University, US. And she is a country representative in Asia Pacific Emergency and Disaster Nursing Network. And she's an instrumental person in planning the Trauma Care Center at Kanihabram in CMC, the quaternary campus, which is going to come. We have started actually to start with the COVID care. And she has held various administrative responsibilities. She will handle the topic on admission policies and procedures. The second panelist is Mrs. Ilavarasi Jesudas, who is currently the Deputy Nursing Superintendent and Professor in Medical Surgical Nursing, and she is heading the Medical Nursing Department with 27 years of teaching experience. She is also the Additional Deputy Secretary of the Hospital Infection Control Committee of CMC. She did have training from advanced training from Adelaide, Australia on geriatrics, and she initiated the geriatric nursing services in CMC. And Mrs. Ilavarasi would handle about home isolation and contact tracing. The third speaker is Mrs. Naomi Naveen. She's a nurse manager and with 9 years of teaching experience. She had her junior training fellowship from the Kansas University, USA, and she was instrumental in initiating the laryngeal stoma clinic, and she helps with that. And she is also the department quality manager. She was actually, during the first wave itself, was trained by our team, and then she was training the nurses in taking the swab. The next speaker will be Mrs. Mary Jansi Joy, who is again a nurse manager, and she's working in the medical nursing department with 20 years of teaching experience, and she's a BLS trainer, and she's a coordinator for the critical care nursing. She's also the department quality manager. She will handle the topic on nursing management of level 3 COVID patients. And the next speaker is Mrs. Mercy John. All of us know she is currently the principal and head of nursing at College of Nursing, Bisam Katak, Odisha, and she is our alumnus, and she has a wide teaching experience, and she's the editor of the Christian Medical Journal of India, and she has authored nursing research textbook, and she has held many positions at the country level as well as in various with her capacities in various professional associations. She was the chairman of the Nurses League of CMEI as well as the Mid India Board of Nursing Education. Currently, she is the principal and she is working among the tribal population of Odisha. And Mrs. Mercy will handle the topic on nursing management of COVID patients in a mission hospital. I would hand over without wasting much time to the speakers, and they will go in the same order. I thank once again all these captains of COVID war in CMC. Thank you, and I hand over to Mrs. Jayalinda Christopher. And before Mrs. Jayalinda starts, I would like to tell you, if you have any questions, please put in the chat box. We will try to answer, and at the end also, we will give you some time to ask questions to the specific panelists. And during the webinar, as the speakers speak, please mute your mic. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning to everyone. Because the time is so limited, I'll just go straight into the topic. The topic given to me for presentation is admission policies and procedures. Though we have been doing admissions in the hospital every day, but there are certain policies and procedures which are so different. The important thing here is we don't want the patients who have symptoms of COVID infection to mingle with other patients who access the hospital services. So it's very important that we isolate these patients and then we try to admit them when they need care in the hospital for their treatment. So we have formulated certain policies related to admission. In CMC, actually what we did is there are two pathways for admission of COVID patients or suspected to have COVID infection. So one is OPD services. So we have established a separate OPD services called as fever clinic. This functions from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., not in the OPD location, but in a separate place where the movement of people is very less. And then we also have the emergency department, which functions 24/7. And a part of the emergency department is cordoned for COVID services, so that these patients don't have access to the many other areas and the patients are isolated. And the emergency department receives patients, initiate the management, and then move them to the COVID wards according to the needs of the patients. So when we look at OPD pathway, patients with SARI symptoms like fever, cough, breathlessness, sore throat, severe body pain, or sometimes abdominal pain, diarrhea, such patients come to this fever clinic. Though these patients come to other OPD services, there are people at the entrance of the OPD to monitor them, to assess them, and then direct them to this particular fever clinic. So in fever clinic, patients are assessed for hemodynamic stability. Their vital signs like temperature, pulse, respiration, oxygen saturation, and blood pressure are assessed by nurses. And we also have physicians who work in the fever clinic. So after the assessment, if the patient is found to be hemodynamically unstable, since it is just an outpatient facility, we move this unstable patients to the emergency department for further management and the investigations. If a patient is found to be hemodynamically stable, then this patient is consulted by the physician who is present in the fever clinic, and the need for RT-PCR test is assessed. And in the same location, we also have a kiosk where the swabbing is done for, nasopharyngeal swabbing is done for these patients. Since these patients are hemodynamically stable after the swab, we send the patient home, we give them the instruction to isolate themselves at home, and symptomatic treatment is prescribed for this patient. So the patient goes home. When the result is ready, most probably the next day morning, if the patient is found to be COVID positive, the result is informed over the phone by the COVID command center, which is set up during this time to handle a lot of the issues and the patient queries. So if the patient is positive, the patient is informed. And then based on the patient's presentation or patient's severity of illness, patient is either recommended for home isolation or recommended for hospital admission. This is how the OPD pathway works. Coming to emergency department pathway, here again, patients who are with moderate to severe SARI manifestations, symptoms, come to emergency department. Or sometimes, since the OPD functions only till 5 p.m., after 5 p.m. if a patient develops any of these manifestations, though it is not very severe, still they come to the emergency department. Here again, we have set up a triage for these COVID-19 patients. So in the triage, the patients are assessed for hemodynamic stability by the triage nurses. And if a patient is found to be hemodynamically stable here, then we advise the patient to go home on symptomatic management. And the swabbing is done in the fever clinic kiosk as OP, outpatient basis, and the patient is taken care of. If we find that the patient is hemodynamically unstable, like for example, level 1.5, 2 or 3, that kind of patients, then immediately emergency interventions are initiated in the emergency department and the patient is planned for admission. We do get patients here, they are like diagnosed already as COVID positive by tested in CMC or elsewhere. So those patients can come. Or patients who the swabbing is not yet done, but they have developed symptoms, so such patients also might come. So we have a mixed group of patients who are already known as positive for COVID and patients who are suspected to have COVID. So here at this point of time, we segregate them. Those who are already diagnosed as COVID, depending upon the severity of illness and the availability of beds, we admit them either in the COVID wards, 1.5 level or two, level 2 wards, or we have to shift them to the level 3, that is the ICU. If a patient is suspected to have COVID symptoms and the swabbing is not yet done, we do the initial interventions or the treatment in the emergency department and then admit them in the suspect ward. We have a ward where the suspected COVID patients are admitted. In that particular ward, we also have a ward and an ICU. So depending upon the patient's severity of illness, they are admitted. In that particular clinical area, swabbing is done for them and they are made to wait there or continue the treatment there till the results are ready. If a patient is found to be negative, then the patient is shifted to a non-COVID ward or an ICU. If the result is found to be positive, then they are shifted to COVID ward or COVID ICU. So this is how the emergency department admission pathway helps, so that it helps us to isolate these patients from the other patients. The chance of spread of infection is very minimal. Looking at criteria for admission in emergency, I'm not going to be explaining that very specifically here because it keeps changing depending upon the government policies in each of those states. And it also depends upon the availability of beds and the current scenario. So based on that, each institutions or the hospitals can formulate certain criteria for admissions, and accordingly the admissions can be taken care. Now at this particular time, especially this week, both our fever clinic is very crowded. You see some pictures here, and the emergency department is also so much crowded with COVID patients. We do have a struggle of bed availability and things like that. So these are two different pathways which really helps us to segregate these patients so that they are not mixing with the other patients and minimizing the risk of infection. Thank you.
Thank you, Jailinda. Over to Mrs. Ilavarasi.
Good morning, all of you. Being listening to Jailinda, she has told that the patients, those who are asymptomatic, as well as patients who are in level 1 and 0, they go for home isolation. So how are they categorized? So all the patients whose nasopharyngeal swabs are done in CMC and said to be positive, they are advised over the phone by the COVID command center to visit the patient has to come and visit the emergency department. In emergency department, the SARI triage is run by the nurse, and who is assessing the patients, their vitals are checked. And for pediatric, there is a separate nurse who is assessing the pediatric patients. And these patients are directed after assessment, they are directed to the doctor who is examining again the patients and advises for home isolation. And what are the some of the eligibility criteria for home isolation? Should be more than 15 years, and now we are including pediatrics also. And all the pregnant mothers, there is a consultation is taken by the OG department, and they advise. And also along with that, the systolic blood pressure should be more than 90, and pulse rate should be less than 90, and respiration and SpO2. The currently, the Tamil Nadu government said SpO2 should be less than 90 and less than 90 for admission. So more than 90 can be categorized as for home isolation. And also all the patients whose PCR is done in CMC only are taken for home isolation by CMC. And also the residents of Vellore and people those who are staying in the lodge are not permitted. There should be an caregiver for 24 hours at home, and they should have a telephone access for their communication, and should have a house with toilet facility. And so all these assessments are done, and the patients are asked to do a self-declaration form that they are agreeing for home isolation, and it is attested by the physician. Two copies are taken, and one copy is given to the patient, and one copy is given to the kept in the hospital. And after that, they are also prescribed for an home isolation kit. There are two types of kit available: asymptomatic kit and symptomatic kit. And after getting the kit, they are directed to the desk where the nurses are. Again, they are helping the patients to understand what is home isolation, and the instructions are being given. And they are also explained that the government official will be visiting their home, and it is their responsibility to follow the government norms. And also, they have to be in. They can contact at any time if for emergency, and the contact number is given to them. And the doctors are also prescribing certain other drugs if as and when needed for the patients. And they are informed that the healthcare worker will contact them twice a day over the telephone. So once they are admission into, if the patients are not eligible for home isolation, they are either they are admitted in the hospital, or if they cannot afford, they are referred to home isolation, which is run by the government program, or they are also referred to VIT Center, Vellore Institute of Technology Center, for government-run home admission. So the symptomatic and asymptomatic kit has got pulse oximeter, one digital thermometer, 500 ml of hand sanitizer, surgical mask, gloves, and along with that, the symptomatic kit has got a budesonide inhaler, 200 meter dose inhaler, one is kept along with that. So, and after that, they are educated how to use the pulse oximeter, how to read it, and how to use the budesonide inhaler. And these are taught to the relatives and to the patient. So the nurse calls over the phone daily in the morning and evening. She notes down the patient's temperature, pulse, saturation, their dyspnea, whether any symptom of dyspnea or any other symptoms, and she continues for home isolation. So there is a monitoring record for each patient, which is being monitored. And the red flags are also assessed when they are calling over the phone. Like if the patient is having continuously more than 102 degree Fahrenheit for more than 5 days, and SpO2 is reducing to less than 92, there is a mental confusion, chest pain, breathing difficulty, or bluish discoloration, or abnormal vitals, they have to report to the COVID command. They can contact the 6333, or the contact number is given to them, so they can contact immediately. And it is, they have to report it to casualty. And for children, it is similar to that. If they are having 102 degree Fahrenheit and above for more than 24 hours, saturation of 95 and less, for feeding, lethargy, any other new symptoms, if they are developing seizures or chest indrawing, and they need to report to emergency immediately, or they can contact the contact number, or they can also contact the home isolation team. The contact number of home isolation team is also given to them. And it is the home isolation team responsibility to ensure that the patient is being admitted in the hospital or visited the emergency department. So these are all the home isolation instructions. They are given and pamphlet both in vernacular language, Tamil and in English. The certain informations are given for them, how to keep a home isolation. And also these are all the team members who are helping and collecting the data for home isolation. And now of late, yesterday, we have started using the software for home isolation. So directly, all the parameters of patients are entered in the software. And also, the home isolation nurse contacts 2 times a day for 7 days. And on the 8th day, the patient is discharged and advised to follow up another 3 days. The patient has to do the self-monitoring. And from 11th day, the patient can start doing their normal activity. And except OJ patients who are isolated for four, they have to be another 7 days. They have to be on home isolation and self-monitoring. And they can report to OG OPD after 14 days. There are certain challenges. They don't respond to the phone call. So if they are not responding to phone call for more than 48 hours, the government is being informed. And there are certain patients are when they call in the middle of the night, they are sick. So they are advised to come to the hospital for admissions. We do see home isolated patients dying because of unavailability of transport system. So that also we are observing. Okay. So going on to the, these are the numbers of what we are having. At any time, given time, more than 400 people are under the surveillance of home isolation under CMC. Okay, so the contact tracing, so once the PCR results are ready, and if the patient is said to be positive, we have a contact tracing team, which is helping, which is run by the nurses as well as the HICC doctors. And it is the primary contact tracing is done for both patients and the staff. And it's not for patients, it is done through, for all of them done through the telephone. And the address verification and onset of symptoms, vaccination status, and the relative working in CMC, and the place of work and vaccination details are observed. And especially they are also asked whether they are, if any OPD visit is being done 72 hours before swabbing. And this is our contact tracing form, which we are using. And for the staff, along with the identity verification, we are also asking whether the last, what is the last working day and what is the contact period for 48 hours, and also whether they are having any degree of risk of infection and exposure, like what is the distance they were talking to people, or the use of PPE or activity during exposure, like eating, etc., vaccination of the exposed person, and details of the family members working in CMC, and what are the contact of all the staff exposed to the indexed person is also assessed. If the staff is untraceable, then the main department is being informed by the HICC. And this is the contact tracing form and the details of the healthcare workers who are positive. We note down all these exposure details, PPE use, or contact time less than 15 minutes and more than 15 minutes. Any person who is having a contact period of more than 15 minutes without a mask, and we have the social distancing is more less than 6 feet is considered as exposed. And based on the vaccination status, if the patient person is a fully vaccinated person, the contact person, then they are not advised for quarantining. If they are vaccinated for one vaccine, based on the exposure, they are quarantined for 7 days. And so all the patient's details are also done by the, every data is collected by the infection control nurse, is referred to the HICC officer, who is deciding about the quarantine, and it is being conveyed to the concerned department for staff. And for patients, we follow up, we explain the quarantine time, and they also visit the ID, emergency department for the follow-up and for the home monitoring. Okay, so to conclude that every patient who is positive in CMC, irrespective of staff or student, are being, the contact tracing is being done, and the nursing team is the part of the contact tracing. The primary contact tracing is done by the nursing team. The primary triaging is done by the nursing, and it is being referred to the physician. And any given time, if there is any difficulties, it is also shared with the team. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Ilavarasi, for sharing your experience and the criteria for home isolation and contact tracing, as well as the various steps involved in this process. Now we'll go on to the next panelist, Mrs. Nahomi Naveen. And Nahomi will share about the nursing management of level 1 and level 2 COVID patients.
Good morning, everyone. Like ma'am said, I'll be talking about the nursing management of patients from level 1 to level 2 in CMC Vellore. Our NS has already explained, we have accorded for better patient care management and also resource allocation. CMC has classified the patient care into various levels. So I'll be talking from level 1 to level 2. Unlike last time, most of our patients who get admitted in level 1 also become sick. So their management is also very important. So patients who have a persistent fever for more than 1 week, and any patient who is less than 65 years but has comorbidity is admitted in level 1 ward, and also elderly patients are admitted in level 1 ward. And the difference from last wave to this time is that we have level 1.5 here, where we have a SpO2 target of more than 95%, where these patients require less than 4 liters of oxygen per minute. And level 2 is where these patients in level 1 and level 1.5 are not maintaining adequate oxygenation, are moved to level 2, where they require persistent requirement of oxygen more than 4 liters per minute, and they are mostly the candidates for non-invasive ventilation. Unlike last wave, these patients who are admitted in level 1 are patients with comorbidities, and also these are patients who go into exertional desaturation. So monitoring is an important character any nurse in this level 1 ward should have, because these patients even with smaller activity go into exertional dyspnea. So monitoring of vital signs is very important, and nurses are given a standing order that if any patient drops down saturation below 94%, they are advised to start them on oxygenation. Apart from that, nurses are involved in fever management, administration of medications and blood sampling, and also in helping them with their nutritional hygienic needs, hygienic and eliminational needs. Also, nurses here teach the patients on breathing exercises and also on awake proning. Level 1.5 patients, like I said, these are patients who need oxygen less than 4 liters per minute. But we cannot take these patients for granted, because they can become sick anytime. So the nurses have to be vigilant and monitor their various respiratory parameters and assess them appropriately. And during this wave, CMC and various other hospitals have been going through oxygen shortage. So the nursing service has instructed and trained nurses as oxygen stewards in every shift. So these nurses who are oxygen stewards monitor the usage of oxygen and also ensure that the patients are on appropriate oxygen delivery device, and set the necessary concentration of oxygen and entry of oxygen charges are taken place. And also they observe and seize the oxygen wastage, and they also assist in ensuring that oxygen is not wasted. And apart from this, from this week, the nurses are also given oxygen concentrators. We are not able to use the vault oxygen because of insufficiency, and to ensure that all our patients get appropriate oxygen, we are given oxygen concentrators to the level 1.5 watts, and the nurses are trained to administer oxygen through this oxygen concentrators which are given. And oxygen is delivered through various devices. So the nurses need to be aware of all the oxygen devices, starting from low flow nasal cannula and simple face mask, quenchery mask, and non-breather mask. We are not using a face mask that much because of the poor fit, but most of our patients are on low flow nasal cannula and quenchery mask and rebreather mask. So nurses are taught on the various quenchery masks and what is the amount of oxygen that is delivered by each oxygen device, and they are educated on how to titrate the oxygen. And also it is important that the nurses are aware that the patients have to be positioned on a preferable, comfortable position, preferably a Fowler's position, for better lung expansion, and also provide oral care and ensure humidification and hydration of the patients. And routine arterial blood gases and pulse oximetry is done for these patients. And also nurses have to watch for the increased work of breathing, like the use of accessory muscles, tachypnea, and visible contraction of sternocleidomastoid muscle. And if the patients are not doing well and they are not reaching the target saturation of 94 with these oxygen therapy, they are shifted into the level 2 care from level 1.5 care. And most of these patients in level 2 care are treated with non-invasive ventilation and awake proning and high flow nasal oxygenation. At this point, most of our patients are not given high flow nasal oxygenation because it is an oxygen guzzler to reduce the oxygen wastage. So mostly we treat them with non-invasive ventilation. I would talk about awake proning. And it is reported that the prevalence of acute respiratory distress syndrome among COVID-19 patients has reported to be 17%. And awake proning is a very low risk and a low cost maneuver, which can help patients with COVID-19 pneumonia delay or reduce the need for intensive care. So you can see on the right side, the picture, which gives us the difference between the supine position and the prone position. Patients, when you put the patients on a prone position, the dorsal alveoli, which is collapsed in the supine position, is better ventilated. And also the ventral alveoli, which is over-distended, is also decreased. Thereby, there is homogeneous ventilation that happens in this prone position. Thereby, it helps in alveolar recruitment and also better lung, better perfusion and ventilation. So nurses are trained to do awake proning for these patients. And in level 2 wards, most of these patients have exertional dyspneas and also have extreme fatigue. So it is the nurses who help these patients to do this awake proning, and nurses have a checklist to follow. And who can be put on this awake proning? Any patient who is on supplemental oxygen and whose saturation is more than 92% for at least 30 minutes before proning can be put on awake proning. Awake proning is nothing but lying on your belly. The contraindications for awake proning is that any patient whose GCS is less than 8, or if a patient has a face, chest or abdomen or spine injury, we are not advised to put them on proning position. And also any patient who is tend to hypotense, who is hemodynamically unstable, refrain from putting them on awake proning. And also if you identify that the patient is having tachypnea and respiratory distress, it is better that we do not put them on awake proning. And any patient planned for imminent intubation, do not put them on awake proning. And also remember that you have to stop proning whenever the patient feels uncomfortable and you see that the patient is hemodynamically unstable, that the patient is hypotensing. Please stop proning and put the patient on a Fowler's position. And if the patient is having a respiratory distress, also get the patient to an upright position. Some of the important nursing care points that I want to highlight when the patient is on awake proning is that take care of the pressure areas, place 3 to 4 pillows, and always ensure that the pressure points are padded, and observe for skin changes. And there should be regular alterations in lying positions. And the patient is not to be in one position for more than 30 minutes apart from proning. And ensure that the patient has foot breaks when you are doing proning, because the proning can be done up to 16 hours a day, but according to us, we are doing 12 hours per day in multiple cycles as the patient feels comfortable. And after you give foot breaks, avoid proning the patient for an hour at least after meals, and ensure that you monitor the vital signs of the patients 5 minutes before and after proning, and also at every position change, because the patients might go into hemodynamic instability. And monitoring should continue even on a prone position. So ensure that all the leads are connected on the posterior aspect, and also the patient is connected on a pulse oximeter. See that the face mask, sometimes even the patients on an NIV is put on prone position. So see that the face mask NG tubes are not decompressing the patient, and secure all the drains and tubes appropriately. On the right hand side, I have put the monitoring sheet of our patients. So they monitor the saturation and the respiration of the patient at 5 minutes before and after, and at the end of every position change. So this is, so the patient is put on left lateral, prone, light lateral, and supine position, and also in upright position. But supine position is not advised for most of our patients because it aggravates the breathing difficulty of most of our patients. And the other important management that is done for patients in level 2 care is non-invasive ventilation. Non-invasive ventilation is basically delivery of oxygen via a face mask, thereby eliminating the need of an endotracheal tube. I want you to understand that NIV, NIV gives positive pressure in addition with supplemental oxygen, thereby reducing the work of breathing and improves gas exchange. There are two types of NIV. One is non-invasive positive pressure ventilation and negative pressure ventilation. We do not use negative pressure ventilation these days. The iron tankers, which were used in olden days, which we are not using now, the non-invasive positive pressure ventilation types are BiPAP and CPAP. And to use these BiPAP and CPAP, we use various interfaces. An interface is nothing but a one which connects the patient to the ventilator. So we are using various types of interfaces, oronasal masks, nasal mask, nasal pillows, total face mask and mouthpiece, and helmet ventilation. We did have some of our patients on helmet ventilation. This helmet ventilation is preferred because it reduces the aerosol generation for these patients. And also it is comfortable for most of our patients because patients can move around. It decreases claustrophobia and things like that. Always, nurses have to ensure the appropriate connection of the NIV with the patient. If you can see in this picture, the face mask has to tightly fit on the patient. There should not be any leak. And at the end of the mask, there should be the green color thing that you see is a heat moisture exchanger. That heat moisture exchanger has to be connected to the mask, which ensures appropriate humidification and also heat moisture exchange, and that has to be connected to the respiratory limb, and that respiratory limb connects to the ventilator. You can see the white thing that is sitting here at the end of the blue tube there. That is the bacterial viral filter that helps prevent the infection to be transmitted into the ventilator. So see that there is appropriate connection of the NIV with the patient. And some of the few important NIV settings that I would highlight, but they have made a video available for all of you to in detail for all of you to understand the ventilator settings. So you need to understand there are three things that you have to remember. One is the mode, the other one is the pressure, the other one is FiO2 in a NIV setting. Okay, you should choose a mode, either a CPAP mode or a BiPAP mode. In BiPAP, I've given down whether it is spontaneous mode, spontaneous timed mode, or pressure cycle mode and timed mode. And then the pressures. In CPAP, there's only one pressure, that is CPAP. In BiPAP, we have two pressures, that is EPAP and IPAP. In CPAP, CPAP acts as PEEP. In BiPAP, EPAP acts as PEEP. What is PEEP? PEEP is nothing but positive end expiratory pressure, which helps you to keep the alveoli open. So in case of a BiPAP, you set two pressures. One is IPAP and EPAP. EPAP, I said, acts as a PEEP. So you should keep a minimum of 0 to 5 centimeters of EPAP so that it gives a constant pressure and keeps the alveoli for better gas exchange. And also nurses should understand there should be a trigger that has to be set. The trigger is nothing but a mechanism by which the ventilator senses the inspiratory effort of the patient and delivers gas flow or a machine breath when the patient is not able to do. And you also have to set a backup breath, 10 breaths per minute, if the patient is not able to breathe. If you are aware of these settings, you will be able to care for a patient. These minimal settings I wanted to highlight. Some of the nursing care of these patients on NIV is that you have to assess the patient on their work of breathing, respiratory rate, tachycardia, and the synchronization of the patient's breathing along with the ventilator, and also our routine ABG values, and also promote appropriate nutrition for these patients. The patients will be on NIV and oxygen on different ratios. So whenever the patient is put on a venturi mask or a cannula, ensure that you give them food breaks and ensure feeding, and also pressure soap prevention on the site where you apply the mask. So apply duoderms, and also whenever you take out the mask, give appropriate massage to that area, and also provide oral care and humidification and bacterial viral filter use. I already explained. Another important concept is cluster care. So whenever you're doing any care to these patients, cluster all your hygienic nutritional needs and along with all the other things so that the patient's oxygen demand is decreased and the patient's rest can be minimized. And communication is an important aspect that we need to be aware of. Patients will be anxious, and with with this mask sitting on them, they'll be claustrophobic. So nurses need to constantly provide that psychological support and keep communicating to them and keep motivating them and encouraging them on the use of non-invasive ventilation, and also preferably position them on Fowler's lateral and prone position. And some of the alarms that you need to be aware of, it will show a low volume alarm when there's a leak, so adjust the straps. And if it will show a high volume alarm when there's some patient machine asynchrony and kinks, so wake up the patients and ask them to breathe normally and also check for kinks. And it will also show disconnection when there is a disconnection from the ventilator side. And it has not been easy for our nurses to care for these patients with their PPEs and various other risks. But nurses have taken up this challenge, and I want to thank all the nurses at this point, and want to end with this verse. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not vain in the Lord. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Nahomi, for sharing your experience with regard to management of level 1 and level 2 COVID patients. I know you are in the front line taking care of the patients, providing care, training nurses, and monitoring the care. Thank you very much. Over to the next speaker, Mrs. Mary Jansi Joy, and she will talk about nursing management of level 3 COVID patients. Over to Mrs. Mary Jansi.
Good morning, everyone. Today I will be discussing on nursing management and challenges in level 3 care setting. As we know, coronavirus disease 2019 is caused by the novel coronavirus SARS-CoV-2, and it has been rapidly evolved into a worldwide pandemic, largely because of its rapid spread, its high mortality, and the lack of definite treatment. With the first case reported in December 2019 in China, there has been an exponential increase in the number of new cases, and we have seen many patients rushing in hospitals for hospital admission. Going to the criteria for admission in level 3 unit, patients may show sign of pneumonia, fever, cough, dyspnea, and tachypnea, plus one of the following: they may present with respiratory rate more than 30 per minute, severe respiratory distress, saturation less than 90 on room air, ABG may show a PF ratio less than 250 mm of Hg, and patients may present with severe ERDS, PF ratio less than 100 mm of Hg, and respiratory failure requiring mechanical ventilation, sepsis, or septic shock. Going to the nursing management at the level 3 patients, we are going to concentrate on key important things on respiratory management, which includes ventilation and oxygenation, hemodynamic stability, management of pain, anxiety, and delirium, nutrition, prevention of infection, and communication. Going to the respiratory management, ventilatory support. Most of our patients are COVID ARDS, SARS-CoV ARDS. So their main ventilatory support is using low tidal volumes. They initially started out 6 ml per kg ideal body weight to 8 ml per kg ideal body weight, and targeting the plateau pressures less than 30 centimeters of water, and using a PEEP greater than 10 centimeters of water in order to improve oxygenation, and also to monitor pulse oximetry, blood gas analysis, and also ventilator parameters. And nurses have to assess respiratory rate and assess for bilateral air entry and breath sounds every hourly. And prone ventilation is to improve alveolar recruitment. As it was discussed in level 1 and level 2 care, it is also being emphasized in level 3 care, where patients are prone at a stretch for 12 to 16 hours a day, or it can be 8 hours of proning and 4 hours of lateral position, again an 8 hours of proning and 4 hours of lateral position. And considering the absolute contraindication for proning, like unstable spine or open abdomen or open chest, and enteral nutrition can also be continued while proning. Going to the nursing care of patients on prone position, ensure that all the E-tube is double secured and all the vascular lines are secured well, and provide pressure relieving devices like provision of alpha mattress, and all the pressure points are being taken care, and hourly the pressure points are being massaged, and also monitoring vital signs while proning. Proning takes a lot of manual effort to make sure the team is ready for proning. At least we need 5 people in the shift to prone a patient, and most of our patients go for proning. So while proning, lot of consideration has to be there to monitor the patient so that the patient does not deteriorate, and also make sure patient is hemodynamic stability is there, and assess for brachial plexus injury, corneal abrasions, and assessing for facial edema, and make sure the patient is positioned in anatomical position. And also to ensure when patients are on proning and other needs where patients need to be on neuromuscular blocking agents, the drug what we usually use is atropurine for patients for paralyzing the patient, for patients who have persistent ventilator dyssynchrony, and also where there is a need for ongoing deep sedation for the patients, and for prone ventilation and patients who have persistent high plateau pressures. And there is monitoring of patients on continuous neuromuscular blocking agents. It is monitoring TOF, a train of 4. It is measured every 8 hourly to assess the nerve function. And also as the last resort, we have assisted and monitored for patients on extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. And going to the measures to prevent ventilator associated pneumonia, patients' head end elevation is emphasized between 30 to 45 degree angle. For regular oral mouthwash is given with chlorhexidine mouthwash every 4th hourly, and subglottic suctioning is done every 12th hourly, and there's regular assessment for the need of extubation is done by daily sedation intervals, and also by using daily evaluation of the spontaneous breathing trial to early wean the patient. As we know, the longer the days the patient is on ventilator, the greater the chances of secondary infections. And the other measures to prevent infection, using new ventilator circuit for each patient, and the circuits are changed only when it is soiled or damaged. And also prevention of aerosol generating procedures by using closed suctioning system. Closed suctioning system is used for patients in ICU for two reasons. One is to prevent aerosol generation and to prevent infection. The other thing is, when patients for as a treatment for patients with ERDS, we give high PEEP. So when the suctioning is, when you do open suctioning, this PEEP is lost, which enhances alveolar collapse. So in order to prevent that, we use closed suctioning system. And also there is use of video assisted laryngoscope for intubations to prevent multiple trials of intubation. And also the ET tube or the ventilator circuit is changed only when it is malfunctions or then when there is a damage. And the heat moisture exchange, as we said earlier, we used to use active humidification to facilitate moisturized air. But now due to COVID, we are using heat moisture exchange, and this is changed every day to prevent clogging of the filter and to facilitate humidification. The other safe respiratory nursing care, we use MDI over nebulization, over active nebulization to prevent aerosol generation, and HME, not humidifiers. As I told you, we don't use active humidifiers, and we use bacterial filter in the expiratory limb, and close endotracheal suctioning is done for patients, and normal saline instillation is avoided to prevent aerosol generation, and avoiding brushing and flushing during oral care. Cautious oral suctioning and avoid suctioning during extubation. Going to hemodynamic support, as we know, the incidence of shock in ICU is 20 to 35%. So we need to assess the fluid balance. So assessing the urine output, blood pressure, capillary refill, and we also monitor the serum lactate levels. And also fluid resuscitation is done conservatively using crystalloids, Dextran and other things, or starch, histeryl is contraindicated. And we also make sure the perfusion targets are met for patients to maintain hemodynamic stability. For a MAP target is above 65 mm of Hg, urine output above 0.5 ml per kg per hour, and capillary refill less than 3 seconds. Apart from that, we also take measures to prevent centerline associated bloodstream infections and deep vein thrombosis prevention. And to prevent deep vein thrombosis, we do passive limb exercises, and tight stockings are applied, or we use sequential or pneumatic compressive devices to prevent deep vein thrombosis and to improve venous return. Otherwise, if patients are either on tight stockings or SCD, or they are on low molecular weight heparin. Management of pain, anxiety, and delirium. Patients, as we told, when there is a need for paralysis, we paralyze the patient. When otherwise, when patients are conscious, they are anxious and they can be delirious. So assessment on pain is done using the CCPOT scale, critical care pain observation tool, which is used for assessing the pain for critical ill patients. And the score is maintained 0 by 8, and patients are given adequate analgesia. We give a combination of analgesia and sedative fentanyl and midaz or morphine midaz. And RAS score is done for agitation and sedation. And the score is maintained 0 or -1, depending on the score. If it is above 1, then the sedation is titrated accordingly. And we also assess CAM-ICU score for delirium. Nutrition. Energy requirement for patients, 30 kilocalorie per kg per day. Protein requirement is 1 gram per kg per day. And fluid requirement, urine output plus 500 ml. And patients are started on early enteral nutrition within 24 to 48 hours of admission. And the nurse's responsibility is to confirm the NG tube is placement is checked. And NG aspiration is done every fourth hourly. And to see the residual volume. If the volume is more than 50% of the volume given, then initially the dose, the amount of fluids, nutrition, which is given to the patients, NG feeds, is brought to 50%, and slowly GI motility drugs are given. And only when the patients don't tolerate the drug, the feeds are being stopped. And the patients are also assessed for bowel sounds, because when patients are on high dose of noradrenaline, patients can go into mesenteric vasoconstriction, so patients may not be able to tolerate the diet. So need for assessment of bowel sounds, and administer proton pump inhibitors to prevent GI bleed. And the other infection control measures, hand hygiene plays an important role, and use of N95 mask and adequate PPE during aerosol generating procedures, and use of negative pressure rooms, and use of HEPA filters and adequate PPE. Going to communication with the health team members as well as the family members using video conference facility, and patients also talk to their family members using the mobile phones. And communication to the patient is very important, because in the critical care unit, they see patients' alarms are on, they might be very anxious. So using verbal and non-verbal communication is very important, talking to them, explaining to them when any procedure is being done, and the use of various communication aids to enhance communication. Some of the challenges what we face in level 3 care, staffing and training of the staff to equip with themselves with the changing protocols and demands from the administration and the government facility, management of the PPE, and adherence of infection control policy protocols by all the categories of healthcare workers, fear and anxiety among healthcare workers, stigma associated with the infection, and discomfort with the use of PPE, because most of the staff are on hazmat. They sometimes hesitate to take time to meet their personal needs, and allocation of the limited resources regarding beds, oxygen supply, and drugs. And in critical care situation, nurses are faced with a lot of ethical dilemmas when they are confronted with different situations. To conclude, nurses play a vital role in the care of critically ill patients with COVID-19. Early recognition of signs of deterioration and timely management help to improve patient outcomes. Interdisciplinary teamwork is the key to success.
Thank you, Mary, for the detailed presentation on management of level 3 patients. I know Mary is a nurse manager in the medical ICU where we admit the level 3 patients. Thank you once again. We'll go on to the next panelist, Mrs. Mercy John. And most of you know, Mercy John has been contributing to nursing for so many years, both in the North and South India, and she's the right person to understand the situation in mission hospitals or the hospitals with limited resources. Over to Mercy John to share about nursing management of COVID patients in a mission hospital.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vatsala and Dr. Bala and Dr. Thomas Ram for permitting this. May I share my screen? From a 2,000-bedded hospital, now we are coming down to a 200-bedded hospital. And I have to apologize in the beginning because if you are asking me the same topic, many people have asked me the same topic and you will hear almost the same thing. So let me go. Before I tell you what exactly the nursing management has been here, let me just briefly tell you about our hospital, Christian Hospital Bisam Katak, or CHB in short. We are a 67-year-old, 200-bedded, secondary-level mission hospital situated in a relatively remote part of India in the tribal hills of South Orissa. And here we provide basic secondary-level care, that is OG, peds, eye, surgery, medicine, and community health. Our hospital runs on a cost recovery basis with a no-profit, no-loss policy, and has been able to make both ends meet since 1979. This is a picture of the hospital. This is the hospital and the entire campus, and you can see the town in the background. What are the challenges we have faced here? Given the lack of advanced healthcare in the region, we are normally up to our necks with an average bed occupancy rate of 105 in the last few years, and with an average 260 OP patients, 210 IP, 17 surgeries, and about 12 deliveries a year. This was our normal. But last year, since lockdown in 2020 March, the patient numbers decreased by about 40%, but subsequently picked up from November, and the entire 2020 clocked an 89% occupancy as against an overflow of patients. In addition to the hospital, we also have a College of Nursing, a lab tech training school, an English medium school, and a community health program in 54 villages and a tribal residential school. And for all these services, we have a total of 380 staff, including 14 doctors and 170 in the nursing department. So being in a remote area, we had limited access to many things, especially PP, oxygen, medical equipment, medicines, etc. And last January in 2020, when we started hearing about this new illness and the rising deaths, especially among healthcare workers in China and Italy, we felt we just had to provide for our staff. Hearing about the costs and unavailability of these things, we started to design and prepare PPE by ourselves. So part of CHB actually became a designing and a tailoring unit. We just had to be independent wherever possible, especially where services were concerned, knowing that actually in a place far away from cities, we had to fend for ourselves because patients, just like they come to big hospitals in cities, they also come to our doorsteps. And just a note, just because we are in a low resource setting, we have to use critical thinking, we have to be well informed of the situation, act and be sensitive to the needs, and push ourselves to situational excellence and social relevance, and also be flexible, but not compromising on principles. So actually in CHB over the last one and a half years, our objective has been to provide the best possible care in our situation with the best possible safety to our staff. So the three pillars of care what we had come up with was containment, clinical management, and community participation, where containment was, in addition to all the containment of the virus, was with relation to education, planning, zoning, clinical management being care, disinfection, triaging, reorganization of procedures and policies, and getting the community to participate in the care and in the education, and also through discharges and deaths. And all these three pillars go together and cannot be compartmentalized. So my talk hereafter will be all three together and not in boxes. So where education and planning was required, from January, we started classes for staff and students, and we had it many times. Every morning, we have daily updates of statistics and information and guidelines from the government, WHO, for the staff and students. And now we have even put it online for our students who are at home. With relation to education, there are placement of health awareness banners in various prominent places. And there's also been a formation of a task force group committee with the members who you see there. And this meets every week. For reduction of transmission pressure on campus, and I have to say, the nursing department with COVID has had a lot of contribution to our hospital, and I'm sure many of the mission hospitals will be able to vibe with this and also take help from this presentation. We went on a Masks for All campaign with the local town clubs, making 40,000 masks and giving it to the Bisamkatak town and the villages, just because we wanted to reduce transmission pressure on our campus. Our next thing was to make masks and face shields for all the staff. So we began doing that here. And this is one link which we made last year, which you can see. We installed hand washing facilities at the entry with water and soap. With regard to distancing, OPD seating, queues were put outside the buildings. Further sheds, extra sheds were made for the surge. And we have increased bed spacing in the different wards. So that those are a few pictures what you can see with relation to distancing. OPD triage. For the OPD, we have had a triage, which you can see here. There's a staff there and another staff who sort of helps with the distancing, and this staff checks temperature. And if there's somebody coming with a fever, they are sent to the fever clinic, which is also there. That's our fever clinic. Casualty is, we also have a pre-triage room and a triage room, which we screen and send suspect patients or COVID patients or other normal patients to the various areas. Labor room, these are the three places where patients enter the hospital. So the labor room also, we have a triage. And if we find any suspect patients or COVID patients, we send them to the isolation labor room, where our labor room staff go there to monitor and conduct the delivery. Then while giving care to any patient on the wards, universal precautions is mandatory, and all categories of staff are provided with the same kind of PP. And all the PP at CHP is now mask, gown, and caps, and these are being prepared in-house except for face shields, which we are buying. Initially, we also made our own face shields, but now face shields are easily available, so we are buying that. This is one of our cleaning staff, and you can see she's in the same PPs as the others. And I'm just showing you the various rainbow colored PP which we have on the wards. The doctors and nurses, everybody in different colors. I'm sure that will give a little joy to our patients also. We also had to re-prepare many, many checklists, prepare and repair many of our checklists and protocols for the changes due to COVID. All nursing care is planned and carried out, prepared, and then our nurses go to the bedside, and with minimum time spent at the bedside, they finish the care and come away. Proning is also of a great help. In our labor room, we have also made a small change in our berthing, the change of position from reclining to squatting. This saves time, energy, and protects our staff also. We also allow one relative to be with the patient inside the ward for the various needs, and every patient is provided with a fresh mask daily, and the relatives are given one face shield which they wear while they are in the wards. You can see a patient with the face shield. And for the disinfection process, what we are doing, we bought one UVC lamp, and then we thought it is far cheaper to make it. So we have made actually 4 UVC lamps for room disinfection and unit disinfections. And that is of real great use. Once the patient leaves the room, it is disinfected with UVC, and then our cleaning staff and nursing staff go in to prepare the room for the next patient. Our CSSD processes and laundry processes, that also we had to install in order to clean and sterilize the masks and PP or wash the cloth PP. We have put home washing machines into various wards so that the linen are initially cleaned before sending them to the laundry. For unidirectional airflow, we have installed exhaust fans in most of the rooms of the patients. We don't use ACs. We have also established a tailoring unit, like I told before, and all the polypropylene material here is sterilized or cleaned with surf and water. And by this, we have saved lakhs for the institution, and that most of it has been done by the nursing department. This is just an example of the mask which we stitch, and all our entire staff in the hospitals have been wearing this mask. I think we have totally used about 20 N95s over the entire year. Waste management also, we had to establish how we did it for COVID-19. We actually use a lot of used IV cartons to collect waste, and then we seal it and send it for disposal. We burn it or incinerate it. We've also got an ICMR testing lab in our hospital with TrueNAT and RAT tests. We have an oxygen plant with central pipelines. Staffing. Our staffing is regular duty with no changes in the duty. The only change we have done is to make it as a continuous duty where people don't go off for a break to their home or for lunch. They have their lunch or dinner while in their room in a staff care center in the ward, and complete the 8 hours duty and then only leave home. Most of our staff have been vaccinated, and we thank the government for that. We also set up an isolation ward. This is the green curtain which was put there, and behind is the isolation ward, where we have totally 44 beds in the isolation ward and a total of 74 beds available in the hospital for COVID patients. That's our isolation ward, a very airy, sunny, and pleasant place for patients. Other interesting stuff which we did was, actually, we prepared hand sanitizer in our hospital, and sodium hypochlorite is being prepared in our hospital. We changed our uniforms of white saris and went into the not so good looking scrubs, but this is what we did. We also set up a staff care center where staff change from their street clothes to scrubs for duty and then bathe or clean up and leave for home. And this year we are slightly better off because we know what we're dealing with. That's our staff care center, where our staff can come in and rest. We also did microscopic checks of the mask material after various disinfection or sterilization methods. Then one more thing, just because we are in a pandemic, we cannot stop our training, our health education for the nursing students. And so even though our students are at home now, or even when they were there at home last year, we found that online classes of more than 1 hour is impossible for our students. How can we take 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 hours? It's impossible. Network issues are there, phone issues are there, and students actually just cannot concentrate like sitting in a physical classroom. So we give them about 7 or 8 hours of material to prepare. And then the next day, the teacher takes 1 hour class, summing it up or clarifying some doubts or teaching. Similarly, this is what happens for clinical teaching. These are some of the things we have done, and I hope that it'll be helpful for the other mission hospitals. And like I said, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. Last year, we had about 70 to about 90 staff who were admitted with about 2-3 days of fever. One person went on to oxygen. This year, I don't know, it's just God's grace and presence here. Very few people have been admitted, and we are very, very thankful and grateful to God for his presence with us, and definitely to the government for the vaccinations. So I'd like to encourage all our nurses in different parts of the country, let us rise to the occasion and be like Esther's in each of our areas. Maybe we are in a place like this for such a time like this. Let us take up the challenge and be true and faithful. Thank you, and God bless you and all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mercy, for sharing your experience of managing a small hospital in a tribal population, among the tribal population, how you manage with the COVID pandemic. And thank you very much for sharing about the three pillars of care, the excellent way of managing. And I'm sure all the mission hospitals and the other hospitals with less resources will benefit out of it. And we thank and praise God for all that good work which goes on under your leadership and Dr. Janiuman's leadership. And we really appreciate the way you manage, like example, as you mentioned, preparing sanitizer. And once again, I thank you very much for spending your time. God bless you.
Dr. Thomas?
Yes.
There are a few questions to be addressed.
Yep.
Some we have already addressed. There are three major questions. One is everybody is asking about sharing the slides, that we have put the YouTube link there. Second one is, there is a question on incident rate of pediatric population. Maybe you can go to the government website and see, because it's updated every now and then for the whole country. But we can tell you, in CMC, around 2,900 children we have screened, of which 440 were positive. Maybe the positivity rate may be around 15%, and of which 17.5% needed level 3 care. And we did have just 2 deaths, and those 2 were associated with comorbidities. And there was one another question in the chat box. What about the waste management when they are in the home isolation? I think Mrs. Ilavarasi did explain that when they give the home isolation kit, the nurse spends a lot of time explaining how to isolate, and the covers are also given along with the kit, and they're also told how to manage. If Mrs. Ilavarasi is there, would you like to respond to this question? There's a question on waste management and disposal of waste in the home isolation.
The waste management is being explained. Actually, in the campus, we are collecting along with the biomedical waste. The Vellore has got a very good waste management system with the government is having a good management system, both biomedical and non-biomedical waste management, solid waste management. So they collect separately all the waste separately, and the patients are instructed to keep separately the mask and the gloves, whatever is being used for these patients, in a separate cover, and hand over the cover.
Thank you. At this point, I would like to thank Dr. Thomas Ram, our Associate Director, and the COVID Command Center Training Desk for organizing this webinar. And I'm sure the nursing fraternity would have benefited out of it. And I thank Dr. Bala, the whole drive in front for the nursing care in the hospital, CMC Hospital. And thank you very much. I thank all the participants, dear friends. Thank you for all that you do every day to keep our people safe and well. May God bless each one of you. Be safe. Take care. God bless. Over to Dr. Thomas.
Dr. Thomas.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vatsala Sandaran and Dr. Bala, for this excellent
Dr. Thomas.
Session.
Dr. Thomas, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your wonderful presentation. I am also happy to inform everyone that we have prepared a four videos on 4 procedures on donning, doffing, oxygen administration with special devices, proning and NIV. Every procedure is explained step by step and they are very informative. I'll be able to send it to Dr. Thomas Ram, and definitely you can, he will be able to send the link to you so that you can use it for your training your students as staff. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Bala, for preparing those videos and the excellent session from the whole nursing team. It is truly amazing to see how much effort goes behind the doors and all the kind of preparation which is happening and the SOPs which have been prepared. Excellent session, not only what we heard from CMC, special thanks to Mercy, who's from our mission network, and how even in the remote places, the healthcare workers, especially the nurses, have responded to this unprecedented need. So thank you all the speakers, and thank you for all the people in the audience for participating, and all of those who were through the YouTube link. I hope this session was useful. And once the session recording is available, it will be uploaded on the link which was provided in the chat box. So thank you very much, all of you, and God bless you. Stay safe. And once more, happy Nursing Day week to all of you. God bless. 3 cheers for all the nurses. Thank you.